Hello, welcome to another Toneless Landscape Oil Painting Demonstration. This is your painter in residence, M. Francis McCarthy, and the painting I'm bringing you today is a 5x10 inch painting. It's called Bay at Dusk. Oh, and I completed this, back in, I'm thinking November, December. Although, maybe it was January. I'm getting confused. I think it was January, actually. Sorry. I get confused. But the good news is it's painting after painting after painting. As long as I can go on, I will go on. A little bit about this painting. It's a bit different. You maybe noticed that right off the bat. I bet you did. I bet you're very observant like that. Let me pull up an image here. Because I'm looking just like you, I'm looking at the early stages right now. Let me pull up an image of the completed painting. Now, I'm going to apologize in advance. There's pollen like crazy out here today. Right, that was a sneeze, and it will be followed by sniffles. So I know it's annoying. I apologize. The pollen's just hitting me like mad. So we're doing what we can. I'm not feeling bad, but hey, whatever. So back into this painting, I did pull up a little image. It's one of these types of things I've been wanting to do for a while. When I first started oil painting, I was about 19 years old. No, I didn't stick with it, or I would have been really good. But I had a guy teach me some landscape painting techniques and things, and I did about 6 paintings, all of which I sold. That should have been a clue. But anyway, I got away from it, got into other things. I was just a callow youth. But some of the paintings I did in that initial foray of paintings were like this. They were silhouetted against a bright sky. And I am always attracted to this sort of image, but I haven't really gone after it in the past. I've done things where the trees were a bit dark against the sky, but not quite this dark. So. Now, one thing I'd like to point out is that in the photographic reference, there would be zero detail in the sky. You might be able to use HDR or something to pull some out, but what you pull out is going to be kind of chunky, because when you get this high a contrast, the camera just goes ding, 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 unless you actually shoot it in HDR, which I don't bother with, because that's like tons of extra space on the hard drive. But I just basically installed some detail of my own, because the way our human vision works is we're going to see some details in the shadows, and the camera won't be able to discern. But so that was one thing about this. Also, I was very interested and attracted to the pattern of the shadows on the grass. Now, I didn't get precious about it. I just made it clear that's what it was shadows on the grass. And this is a place where, were you to look at my photo reference, you'd see there's a very intricate pattern of lights and darks, and I've got caught up in that stuff in the past, and for me, for the way I paint, it's a total trap. Here comes one of the sniffles I told you about. Hold on. Apologize for that. Like I said, dealing with pollen. But I'm here for you. I'm doing the job anyway. So, back to what we're talking about. Which I guess we can maybe make a little bit of a topic of this video. I know I've done photo reference a lot, but it's a real thing. It's a real thing you got to reckon with. And the sublimation of detail is super, super critical. You look at this painting and you go, wow, that is pretty simple. You know, let me tell you, my photographic reference isn't simple. There's a ton of detail down in the lower left. There would be detail in that. Actually, I don't even believe that mountain in the background was there. It would have been because of the photo focal point. Would have, even though there was quite a lot going on in the background, it was a tiny little strip full of detailed whatever. Were you to paint that in, it wouldn't feel good as a painting. We accept this in a photo automatically because we know how to look at photos. Everyone does. It's automatic in the modern human. It would be interesting, though, if you could bring a human from the pre-photography past into the now and see what their perception of photos were. You might be surprised that they weren't actually seeing things quite right. At least at certain focal lengths, things would look very odd to them, where we just accept it as modern people. We see it all the time and we accept it. We know what it is. But so that's one thing as a painter. You got extreme focal length. Like here, I was probably as wide as my lens would go to get as much as I could of the scene. That's going to make everything in the background super tiny and also create a bunch of weird distortion too. Don't do that. Don't paint that weird focal length then. Use the photo as inspiration. That's why I use photos, because I can come up with things that I would never be able to come up with just out of my imagination. Although I'm hopeful, like George Ness, when I get into my 80s, I will have had so many landscape paintings under my belt that my internal vocabulary of the landscape would be so dense and rich that I would be able to produce things just out of my imagination the way that he did. Although, another sniffle, pardon me. Sorry about that. If you read the biography of George Ness by his son, which I highly recommend, you can find it free with a little bit of clever Google searching. You'll find a PDF free. Good luck finding the actual book. I'm sure it exists. But anyway, that would have been from, 1900. He would liked using his friend's sketches as reference. He liked painting over the top of his friend's paintings, or sometimes his son's painting. There was one instance where his son was wondering where one of his paintings had gone, and his dad didn't even fess up, but later on he had saw that there was a ridge underneath one of his dad paintings that would have aligned with the horizon line in his painting that was missing. So he knew then that his dad had painted over his painting. But why was he doing this? Well, because he needed something other than just a blank canvas and his imagination. He didn't need a lot. And you could say, well, geez, why didn't he just go out in nature and make his own sketch? Well, I'm sure he did plenty of that, but he was kind of playing a little game with himself. And I think I'm becoming more and more hip to that. You sort of do something, but with one part of your mind, but the other part's not actually aware of what you're doing. And this is one of the secrets to creating more sublime creative images, okay? If everything you do is overt and straightforward and planned, that rigidity is going to follow through into your canvas, and you will not achieve a magical sort of look. It's just not going to happen. Anyway, getting back into, so either, you know, photo reference or the same thing would apply if you're a plein air painter. Whereas if you're a plein air painter, you've got one really big advantage, which is that the light's changing and you have to move quickly. By the way, let's just take a little second here. We're talking about this image. You can see when you compare this to the final image that the white tones that I'm painting in the sky right now are not yellow, okay? But if you look at the initial image for this video, you'll see it's quite yellow, and that is accomplished with glazing, and that's coming up, so stay tuned. You'll see the painting sort of shift, and sometimes the lighting shift, because it'll be a different painting session on a different day. Anyway, it just shifted there, and probably the first thing you're going to see. So I didn't necessarily have a plan. I'm going thinking, well, maybe I did in this case. There, I just hit it with straight up yellow. The white's gone. The value, though, is pretty much stayed. But this is an effect that I just did that would be impossible to paint, paint in opaquely, almost impossible. You could probably do it if you really, really worked at it a little bit at a time, but easy as pie to do the way I did it, which is just to glaze it in. And I will be painting in some some little more brightness, but to get that overall feeling as glazing, which is very powerful. Anyway, getting back to sublimation of detail, that takes a lot of practice to know what details to eliminate. And again, a lot of times it's like a bit of hide and seek with parts of yourself as you're working. It's like if you're too, the word overt keeps coming to mind. If you're too overt, if you're too heavy handed, if the front of your brain is driving, your painting's not going to be good to look at. It needs to be a real balance. And I've talked about this in the past too. It's like good artwork, good painting, good music is a real balance struck between unconscious and conscious actions. The unconscious has got to be the wellspring of inspiration and substance, whereas the conscious comes in and is moving the paint around. You know, it's actually grabbing the brush, it's actually putting the strokes down. I've noticed, I'm not a meditator, but I notice when I'm painting that I am in sort of a meditative sort of state, almost like a trance. And that said, I could be having a conversation with you or anyone walking into my studio and they wouldn't even know that I'm sort of oscillating between conscious and unconscious very rapidly. And it's not a big deal. It might seem like I'm trying to make it out that it's some special state of mind or something, but it's just a default. And trust me, you can do bad paintings in this default state as well. So don't think that this is a magic bullet, but it is important. It's important to even if you're not noting it while you're working, it's important to open yourself up to the inspiration and guidance that's maybe coming through from we'll just say universe, for lack of a better term. There is a better term, but we'll keep this agnostic. It flows through you. This is very much true of the music for me as well. I mean, I look back at music I made and I go, how did I even do that? You know, well, it was just following the thread of inspiration one step at a time. And the conscious does come in. The conscious, both aspects are totally imperative in the process. They both have to be there. If it's all unconscious, you're just doing nothing. There's nothing to guide or direct it. The ego's got to be present. In fact, what other part of you has a desire to create, you know? But what you need to open up that channel to the universe, which is, say, stick with the universe here. And but you can't just be a big flapping open channel. Nothing will happen. Nothing of any consequence. It's got to be a balance struck. So hopefully that's some helpful insights into painting today. I'm trying to give you some really good information, and hopefully that helps you with maybe understanding how I arrived at this painting, which I think is pretty good. Not bad, eh? Anyway, I'll be back real soon. Oh, yes, this weekend I have a Georgianess for you that you're really going to like. So if you haven't liked this video yet, could you do me a favor? Click that like. It tells YouTube that this is a good video to put in front of people that maybe weren't aware of it. Also, subscribe if you haven't. You know what the bell does. It means that they bother you every time I make a painting. So, till I see you again, which is going to be real soon, take good care and stay out of trouble.